weather as well. So it's my pleasure to introduce Nathan Stubina, Nate Stubina, to host this morning's plenary on innovations. And Nate has a bachelor's degree from my university, Department of Metallurgical Engineering at McGill, so on that score I've known Nate a long time. He's a PhD from the University of Toronto. Worked with Falconbridge in various locations, including the refinery in Norway and Falconbridge International in Brussels. Worked with Naranda at the Horn Smelter, where he earned his Six Sigma Master Black Belt. Barrick Gold in various locations as well, in particular the Tech Center in Vancouver and corporate office in Toronto. He's now Managing Director of McEwen Mining. He's past President of Metsoc. He's VP International of CIM. And as you know, he's the Technical Program Co-Chair of IMPC 2016. I think looking back over the 2 years, Nate's the only one who made every single one of our monthly conference calls, so he's got a big gas tank, and I appreciate all the work that he's done on behalf of this Congress. So I welcome you up, Nate, to host us through this morning's plenary, Innovations.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Bonjour et bienvenue. Before we kick off the session on innovation, which will be a continuing theme from the plenaries you heard on Monday and Tuesday, as well as all the great talks you've heard at the session, we have a tribute, and I'd like to bring up Cyril O'Connor, who's the chair of the IMPC, to make a short tribute. Cyril, please.
Nate. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a brief tribute that I'm going to present in honor of a dear departed colleague of ours, Roberto Serini Villas Boas. The International Minerals Processing Council has an award called the Distinguished Service Award, which is made occasionally at congresses in recognition of sustained and noteworthy contributions to the cause of minerals processing globally, as well as the activities of the Council and Congresses. As a result of a secret ballot that took place earlier this year in about April, it was unanimously decided by the Council that we would make this award at the Quebec City Congress to our former colleague, Roberto Villas Boas. Previous recipients of this award have been Nat Arbiter in Beijing in 2008, Jacques Astier at the Brisbane Congress, and most recently, Barry Wills at the Congress in Santiago. Now, sadly, within a month of informing Roberto that he was going to be the recipient of this award, and this award would have been presented to him at tonight's banquet, Roberto passed away on the 15th of June of this year. He was globally renowned for his contributions in the arena of sustainability in mining and minerals processing, and in fact was the founder chair of the Sustainability Commission of the IMPC. Roberto's reputation globally is well known to all of you who would have been engaged in any way with the whole area of sustainability. So we pay tribute to Roberto. We thank him for his enormous contributions over many years, dating back to the São Paulo IMPC in the 1970s. Roberto was the founder director of CETEM, and I'm very happy to be able to tell you that at a ceremony in Rio de Janeiro on Monday afternoon of this week, the current director of CETEM, Professor Fernando Lins, presented the tribute scroll, which was prepared for Roberto, to his daughter, Harinas, who was at the ceremony, and here are two pictures that I received yesterday afternoon. And at CETEM, they've also renamed their main lecture venue after Roberto. So Roberto, we pay tribute to you, we salute you, and we thank you for all that you did for us during your life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cyril, for those fitting words. Well, if there's one thing I love is a captive audience, so I have a couple of things to show. If you Google the words lack of innovation in mining, lack of innovation in the industry, you'll get something like 15 million hits. Things like this, you know, why the mining industry is slow to innovate, the lack of innovation in mining. And in fact, it's easy to come up with some dire words like this. Not as bad as the one in the bottom corner, the death of mining. Hopefully we won't see these. This is actually the cover from one of the magazines from a long time ago. So the theme here is innovation in mining, but I was recently asked to write a paper for the Northern Mining, and I switched it around, and I wrote, is mining innovation an oxymoron? And we'll challenge some of our speakers today to prove that's wrong. So in line with the Olympics that just were held in Brazil, I've been studying hurdles, and there's lots of ways to overcome hurdles. The first one is the bottom is the elegant way, like you'll see the runners. And there's other ways. You can crash right through them. You can go under them. I'm not sure what some of these people are actually doing. But some of the themes, you know, we see is mining innovation operating at a slower pace than other industries. And I think our speakers will touch on that. So we know things have gotten bigger, bigger trucks, bigger flotation cells, bigger ball mills, and so forth. But is this the best way to go? And most of the recent innovation has been due to a lack of products or resources like people, water, power, etc. And the question for today is how can mining companies accelerate at a faster pace? And that's really the theme of the conference and definitely the two speakers for this morning. So the first speaker today will be very well known to the members of the IMPC community, is Dr. Barun Gorain. Dr. Gorain has more than 25 years of experience in plant operations, capital growth projects, and technology management with a focus on operational excellence and improving project economics. He is presently a director in Barrick Gold's corporate office in Toronto, focusing on technology breakthroughs for optimization of operations and capital projects along with integration of the mining value chain. Previously, he served as a group leader at Cominco, now Teck, and he also worked at Mount Isa Mines, now Glencore, Coal India, and Hindustan Zinc, now Vedanta. Dr. Gorain has a PhD in metallurgical engineering from the KMMRC in Australia, and a first-class BTEC degree in mineral engineering from the Indian School of Mines. Dr. Gorain serves on the board of the JKMRC, and also the steering committee of the Canadian Mining Innovation Council, CMIC, processing group. Dr. Gorain has participated as an invited speaker in various international forums and has made many contributions to book, journal, conference proceedings, and so forth. He has several patents, including his AMBS technology, and that technology is commercially used in the industry. His goal is to be a leader in developing the next generation of mining that is highly profitable yet sustainable, involving innovative stakeholder engagement, technology, and business models with a sole focus on making this world a better place to live. His talk will be on delivering value through innovation and breakthroughs. Barun?
Thanks very much, Nathan. It's an honor to be here to be able to share some of my experiences and thoughts. Now, to maintain the tradition of mining companies, safety is important, and I really mean it, what's there. Because I've seen in many situations, the alarm bell is ringing, yet people are busy doing their things, finishing their phone calls, tweeting, going to the washroom, but when a situation like this happens, exit. Don't muck around, as the Australians say. Don't just muck around, just get out of the building. Now, in my talk, I'll start with the question on, is the mining companies innovative? And is the focus on innovation lopsided? Then I'll talk about some of our experiences on open innovation and invention, and the idea is to be able to make some breakthroughs. And then I'll talk about some of the mining paradigm shift required to make really things possible for the 21st century. Now, in my talk, I'll dwell on two different questions. One is on what is possible, which is P, and what is needed, it is indicated as N. So I will be talking about P and N quite frequently, so please take note of what P and N actually signifies. Now, this is really interesting. Now, this is from the authors of the very famous book, Breakthrough. And if you haven't read this, I highly recommend it. Interestingly enough, that what they have found from lots of research for manufacturing and with high-tech companies, that no one has ever created a breakthrough from open innovation. I was actually puzzled when I started this, when I was actually reading through it. Then I realized, actually, you know, this is so true. I'll explain why. If you look into innovation, what is innovation? Innovation is all about taking an idea all the way to commercialization, which is more application focused. So the focus is really about what is needed in the industry right now. And the application focus could be on business, could be on social needs, whereas what's possible is a completely different ballgame, where the invention come into play, which is more research focus on generating new knowledge, discovery, new insight, things like that. So what we have found, that breakthrough actually involves a combination of invention and innovation. That's really critical. So what's happening is a lot of focus on the innovation side of things is actually you're focusing on the application side of things. Now, that's good. You can still optimize the process, but you're optimizing the existing operations or processes. But unless you have invention along with innovation, breakthrough doesn't happen. Now, this is a very standard S-shaped technology maturity curve. As you can see in this curve, that most of the breakthroughs are coming from corporate R&Ds, whether you take Apple or Cisco or any other company, IBM, most of the breakthroughs are actually coming from corporate R&Ds, and very few breakthroughs from university research and from the operations. And the reasons are quite obvious, because universities focus on invention. They're not really so much inclined towards actually application, but they're focusing on invention, whereas the operations, they're focusing on day-to-day needs. Whereas the corporate R&D tend to balance these two, and that's where most of the breakthroughs happen. Now, in the mining industry, which is really quite interesting, that the tendency is to actually optimize the routine, to pursue incremental innovation or improvements, and to really register truly innovative. And that has been happening for many years now. We are still in the existing mining paradigm with the challenges that we have been facing for the last many years. So the question is, what do we need to focus on? Our tendency is to focus on what's needed, and a lot of times we focus on the mining trends and what's happening right now, and that's where a lot of the efforts go into, which is not bad, which is nothing wrong with that. It's just that it's limited to our existing paradigm. If you really want to have a breakthrough, it has to be done differently. So what we do is we look at the mining trends, for example. For example, you see how the trends are changing globally, and you can see there's a lot of mining activities happening in Asia right now, huge amount of activities. Obviously, Australia is a big mining country, and so is North America, especially Canada. And there's a lot of activities happening in South Africa, and in Brazil, in Chile, and other parts of South America as well. But you see the real focus is actually happening in China and in many Asian countries. Now, if you look into the total overall global metal production, iron ore, gold, and copper, they represent almost 65 to 70% of the total metal production. So obviously, the focus of technology has been in those areas. Quite a bit. Now, if you look into the world mineral production, there has been a quite steady increase from about 4,000, you know, million, you know, tons, all the way to almost getting into 18,000. Now, if you look into the yellow side of things, that's really where the Asia is dominating. From a Europe point of view, obviously, it's stagnating quite a bit, and North America is a little bit increasing. But overall, you see there's a lot of metal production happening from Asia. Now, this is really interesting, and in fact, this data actually I verified with the World Mineral Council, and that's true that a significant proportion of the metal production is actually coming from unstable or extremely unstable jurisdictions or politically unstable countries. Now, this is really quite interesting because this really has a major impact on how the technology is actually dissipated, how the technology is developed. So there are a lot of implications on how the world mineral production is going into. Again, you can see, if you look into the value of the metal production, only two or three countries producing almost a couple of trillion dollar worth of value. Now, in the last 5 to 10 years, or even maybe 20 years, what we have seen is a lot of focus on production and growth, a lot of focus on what's needed, and instead of focusing on value generation. And this has really hampered the progress of the mining industry, as you all know. And let's see what has happened in the last few years. Since 2000, the productivity is actually falling down quite significantly. In fact, if you look at the OSIMM August publication, they're saying that the productivity has now stabilized and possibly going up. But you can see this falling productivity trend, which is actually very disturbing. Now, what we also realize that even though we had very high metal price, but our cash cost actually went up quite significantly, very high. Now, even though the metal price has dropped, but the cash cost hasn't dropped as much. So this is one of the challenges we are dealing with right now. And obviously, the falling grades for all commodities, you know, it's a downtrend, and this is something we have to accept as a reality. So what's the overall outcome? Is that the ore value is actually going down because of declining grades, because the ore bodies are getting more and more challenging, more deleterious elements, more penalty elements like arsenic and mercury and things like that. So the ore value is going down, but the costs are going up because you need high capital processing plants, for example, higher operating costs to deal with these challenging ore bodies. And on top of that, your revenue is decreasing because of a lower metal price, and also recoveries are lower because we're dealing with very complex ore bodies. Overall, there's a squeeze in the margins. So the mining industry lost about 73% of its market cap since 2011. So everybody is asking the question that what Nathan just raised, is the mining industry innovative? So when you compare with the high-tech manufacturing, obviously the productivity is significantly lower for the mining industry, even though we're very close to the total manufacturing, you know, whether it's chemical industry or oil and gas, but still we are down below there. So the question is, what's the difference between mining companies and high-tech companies? And interestingly enough, there are actually quite significant differences. Obviously, the entry barrier for high-tech are much lower compared to the mining industry. And high-tech industries focus on new products, whereas for the mining companies, you know, gold is gold and copper is copper. It doesn't matter who produces it. And for high-tech industry, the strategy of first mover is really critical, whereas for the mining industry, we look at first adopter. You know, never get into first mover scenario. And for high-tech industry, like the Googles and the Facebooks, you can see whoever can invent, you know, huge amount of payback. Whereas for the mining industry, the returns are pretty low, you know, 6 to 10% in the last maybe 10 to 20 years. Lead time is very short for high tech, whereas for mining, it's very, very high, like 7 to 10 years. And for high tech industry, the price control is the key, whereas we have no price control. High tech industries depend on disruptive innovation. We depend on, you know, economies of scale, you know, big trucks and big milling equipment, you know, big float machines, things like that. And if you look into the actual cash going into R&D, it's almost 30 to 50% in the high-tech industry. We are anywhere from 0 to 8%. So what's the difference? Difference is mining industries focus on what's needed. That's drive innovation. Whereas high-tech companies, they focus on what's needed and what's possible. That's the big difference. So now within Barrick, we are trying to focus on breakthroughs with balancing open innovation and open invention, and we're kind of borrowing some of the high-tech model. And the whole idea is to reduce the implementation time. The question, does it actually work? So we have been looking and doing a lot of work on this side, and I'll show you some examples on some of the successes. But I'd like to give you a snapshot of some of the innovations in mineral processing. Obviously, this is not a complete list by any means. So what I've done, I categorized into four different areas. One is energy and greenhouses, where we're talking about mine-to-mill, novel combination. We started with big SAG mills. Now we have HPGRs and ultra-fine grinding. In efficient separation, there's a lot of new ideas and technologies on coarse and fine flotation, whether it's flash or hydrofloat or microcell or Jameson or stage flotation reactor, novel chemistries. We also have the next generation of max separation, electrostatic separation, you know, classification, enhanced gravity like Nelson and Falcon. There's a lot of focus on water and dry processing as well, like seawater separation, water recycling, including, you know, deep cone thickeners, dry stacking. And from a mining chain value perspective, we have integrated operations really paying a lot of attention nowadays, and remote operations, and near-to-face processing, which may involve in-pit crushing and conveying, in-situ leaching. But to really make this happen, we need enablers. Obviously, there's a lot of focus on on-stream analyzers and sensors and process control, mineralogy, geometallurgy, modeling and simulation. But it's really key that health and safety is actually is a very important part of the enabler that actually can help us do even better. There's a lot of focus on education, R&D, and training as well. And of course, the most important of all is the digitization. Strongly feel that digitization actually is going to transform the mining industry in many ways, which is already happening. So this is a snapshot. The question has always been, there's not a shortage of technologies. The question is, how do we apply this technology, how do we actually deploy them in a very short frame of time? So that's the challenge. Now, within Barrick, we are focusing on three different areas of innovation. One is on incremental, 5 to 10% productivity gain, step change, 10 to 30%, and paradigm shift more into 50% range. And to really expedite the innovation, we have like a layer approach. One is on cash flow improvement in the existing operation. Then we're looking at productivity improvements. And the idea is to, the S-shaped curve that I showed before, how do we keep on going? And then we look into step changes like integration and then real radical innovation. And the whole idea is to focus on four different areas, like mining, for example, mining intensity, labor intensity, energy intensity, and obviously, how do we optimize the value from capital that we put into our projects. So the whole idea of this is to expedite and scale fast so that we can deliver innovation fast. Now, there's another area that we are focusing on. If you look into any operation, there's a lot of focus on execution. Execution, production. Planning is good, but improvement is always as an afterthought. Whereas now the strategy is more into planning, execution, improvement should be highly integrated so that you get the maximum value. So within Barrick, we have five-step approach. One is, step number one is problem diagnosis. Number two is testing the potential solutions. Number three is identifying the optimum solution. Number four is large-scale validation and planned implementation. And I'll show you how this five-step approach has helped us in actually making improvements, not just incremental, but also step changes. Now, step one is normally forgotten. It's done, but in a very limited way. But if you really want to go into the root cause problem, it's very expensive and time-consuming. And many companies, many operations, I know they skip the step completely. They get into testing potential solutions, and once you get into that, obviously you're into what's needed mode. And then the third step is more into optimum solution, where the business kind of skills come into play. And then as you go into step number four and five, it gets more complex. But the point I'd like to make here is the five-step approach is actually a multidisciplinary approach. In step one, we're talking about problem diagnosis, and the idea is to get new knowledge or insight where we need to interact with academics, maybe universities or centers of excellence, and to people or consultants who knows the subject very well. So this is a very important area which is often skipped, and that's where invention doesn't happen very often within the mining industry. Step number two is more testing potential solutions. That's where commercial labs are really important because we need to have numbers which actually make sense. This is really critical. So this is where we have a different kind, we need a different kind of skill. Now getting into step number three, which is an optimum solution, we need to understand the business side of things now and also the technology application. So, and then when you get into step number four, which is large scale validation, we need to understand the nitty-gritty of the operations. So that's where the operation skills come handy and also the engineering skills. Now step number five is more on implementation. This is really a site-based champion typically, and the idea is to be able to interact with all the different disciplines. Now this is really critical. This is where I see many of the projects, good ideas, excellent ideas fall off the rail because you don't have somebody who has the capability to interact with, you know, academics, universities, you know, commercial labs and engineering companies and the business people and the operating people. Very, very difficult to find that kind of a skill set. So this is where our focus has been, to find that kind of people who can actually manage the project and deliver. I'll show you some of the successes we had. Let's start with some of the incremental successes. As a gold mining company, we always ask the question, where is the gold? You know, and we're dealing with very complex ore bodies, and our gold is in, you know, four different types of pyrite. It could be in iron oxide, it could be in carbonaceous matter, it could be in silicates, anywhere. The question is, can we quantify where the gold is? So we call it, you know, quantification of gold deportment. Now, many companies I know and many operations, they skip the step completely. But here, what we did, we actually collaborated with many companies like IP Mins and Laval and Surface Science Western and many other companies, many other universities and centers of excellence to develop our own gold deportment technology. So I'm happy to say that now we have this, and this has provided such amazing insight and helped us solve many problems. This is an example from Papua New Guinea, one of the operations we have in Porgera. And you can see the horror in the face of a processing engineer when they see their gold tailings in their float tailings actually keeps increasing, and we have no control on what's going on. Now in Porgera, they have a flotation plant where the gold is actually in the pyrite, so that they make a pyrite concentrate and send the concentrate for autoclaving and then leaching. And when you see a trend like that, the question is, how do you know what's going on? So we use the five-step approach to find out what the problem was, and the problem was actually quite simple because it's an old plant, things were going down from a mechanical point of view. What we found that the control was really critical. So we upgraded the flotation plant completely. We put portage froth cameras, which is on the right side, on the left side. And we also put Blue Cube technology, which is online mineralogy, because there we were trying to understand and quantify carbonates, sulfide, sulfur, and sulfur as well. And by doing this control through all these different sensors, our recovery improved significantly. And definitely the operation actually got a lot of value out of it. Even though $6 billion doesn't sound like a lot of money, but definitely it was a big opener, eye-opener for us. Another operation, Cowell, which we don't own anymore, but interestingly enough, during the commissioning, we had issues with froth recovery in the OK200s. At Cowell, we have a flotation plant. Idea is to produce a pyrite concentrate. The pyrite concentrate goes into fine regrinding and then to leaching. And the idea is to maximize your gold into your flotation. Now, in this, during the commissioning, what we found that the froth is coming just from the first few cells, and the last six or seven cells are running empty. So the question is what to do there. So we used the five-step approach to find out what the problem was, and the problem actually was very interesting, very, very simple. Initially, we had some consultants who said, oh, put froth crowders and this and that, costing us $1 million. But once we use a five-step approach, we realized that actually is a problem of distributing the fast-floating pyrite. So what we did, we actually let some of the fast-floating pyrite go towards the back end, which allowed floating of the slow-floating pyrite by building stable froth. So simple measures like that could be actually very instrumental. Like here, what we did to really control that profile, bank operating profile, we actually put Metso froth cameras. It cost us about $500,000, but the payback was 1.5 years. So this kind of improvements definitely, you know, it actually helps the operation to really look into different ways of solving problems. Another example, this is from Bulyanhulu in Tanzania, which is a copper-gold operation. And in the early days, they used to have a float plant, and they used to produce a copper concentrate. But the problem is the copper concentrate they were producing had a very low grade because the gold is in pyrite. So to maximize the gold and copper recovery, they have to produce a copper concentrate which is very low in copper. I'm talking about 8%, 10%, 12% copper. And can you imagine higher freight cost? And on top of that, obviously, you're not getting the right kind of payables. So by doing the five-step approach, what we realize is that actually there's a lot of gap between the limiting grade recovery curve and the actual plant production. So there, what we did, we put a leaching plant on the tailings based on the five-step approach. And now what we do is we depress the pyrite and let the gold go into the tailings and we leach it. And now we have a high-grade copper concentrate, which is about 25%, good payable, less freight cost. Overall, it improved the gold recovery and the copper recovery. So another example of how a systematic approach could be very useful. This is a gold deposit we have in Alaska, and it's actually, the gold is refractory, but it's actually in arsenopyrite. Now, arsenopyrite oxidizes very fast. So we had to develop a new technology, we call it mill chemistry float. And by doing that, we were able to maximize recovery of gold in arsenopyrite. And this actually helped us in adding about $170 million to our project. Obviously, again, the five-step approach was very helpful. So while we were doing this, you know, we found that actually, you know, if we have a systematic approach, it actually works for us. So the question is, can we get into step change improvements? Now, this is where I'll show you some examples how this also helped in developing some amazing breakthroughs. As you know, Barrick actually in the early days, we developed the refractory gold processing, which transformed the gold industry, which made the Carlin-type deposit more economical. And it was first commercially used at McLaughlin in the US. And now, from that technology, the famous gold strike operation was born. Now, in this talk, I'll talk about the MBS technology and the thiosulfate technology, which got award just a few days ago on the innovation. It was an innovation award awarded by MetSoc. Now, the MBS technology is interesting because this is about, you know, copper or copper gold flotation using seawater. What we found that when we use problematic water like raw seawater or brackish water, conventional flotation with lime doesn't work because of the pH buffering effect. So we had to develop this technology, we call it AMBS technology, which actually, you can actually depress the pyrite at a natural pH. There's no need for lime, no need for cyanide to depress the pyrite, and we found significantly better metallurgy. I'll show you some of the examples. This is a project we have in Chile with raw seawater, and when you use lime or the conventional process, flotation just doesn't work. But the AMBS definitely works quite much better than the lime-based process. This is a project we have in Argentina and Chile, and we don't have any water problem there, but the issue is the chemistry. When you grind, the natural slurry pH is less than 2. The question is, how do you separate the copper and the pyrite at this low pH? But with the MBS, we were able to do that at pH 4.5, and you can see that both copper recoveries and gold recoveries are significantly higher with the MBS process. This is a project we have in Pakistan. It's called Recodic project, which is one of the biggest projects I've ever seen from a copper gold point of view. Again, the MBS process was very much better. You can see recoveries improved significantly with the MBS. And in fact, it added about almost close to $800 or $900 million to the project. So that was very significant. So now we have two commercial applications of MBS. One is in, which is operating at the Esperanza operation in Chile, which is owned by Antofagasta Minerals. Well, Antofagasta Minerals, they were using a lime-based conventional process, only to find out that with raw seawater, it doesn't actually work. So they switched to our technology, and it has been working quite well for the last many years. Now we have, this technology is now being used at our Jabal Sayid operation in Saudi Arabia, which is a copper operation. And the benefit was about close to $1 billion for the project because of this technology. So that was quite significant. And Jabal Sayid, it was commissioned last year, towards end of last year, and it already produced 5.5 million pounds of copper. And they are targeting about 100 million pounds by second quarter of 2017. So definitely that's quite a big achievement for us. And this technology has definitely helped us. Now the thiosulfate technology is really interesting one because the gold industry has been using cyanide for how many years? 150 years, more than 150 years. And thiosulfate is not a new technology, new idea. But again, with a five-step approach, we actually went quite deep into the root cause of this technology, and what we found that certain insights could actually make the technology happen for us. So after we got that insight, we had a demo plant at Gold Strike operation, which ran quite successfully, and now we have this technology in operation, which definitely made a big impact to the bottom line of the operation. So again, these two technologies definitely have helped significantly in providing the confidence that we wanted, really to make things happen for us. So definitely, if we have a systematic approach, it works quite well. But I must remind you that unless we have open invention and open innovation working together, it is very difficult. Now the question is, how do we get into paradigm shift? That's really the big challenge we have right now. I'll give you an example where we need this. We have a project in Nevada, which is a triple refractory ore, which means we have gold in pyrite, we have got organic carbon, or TCM, they call it, and we also have arsenic on top of that. And huge resource, 30 million ounces at 3 grams per ton, but the challenging part is very high strip ratio. I'm talking about an average of 33. It takes you almost like 1 kilometer, down deep before you access the ore body. You're talking about 7.5 or 8, billion tons of open pit. You have to move like 600,000 tons per day of waste. Obviously, with all these challenges, NPV is negative at the existing gold price. You need about $1,800 to make it happen for us. On top of that, the capital is about $8 billion. So the question is, how do you make these projects work for us? How do you get returns of more than 15%? So obviously, we need a paradigm shift here. The question is, how do you go about it? Now, if you look into the existing mining paradigm, at least in the gold industry, 99.9% of what we actually mine is waste. So we mine the waste, then we haul the waste, then we process the waste at a very high cost, and then we try to find a place to store it. What it means is, basically, you have a huge footprint, you need lots of water, you need lots of energy, and obviously you get conflict with the communities and stakeholders. Now, my feeling is this is a poor case for business and license to operate. I don't think we can go on like this in the next century or the next generation to come. We have to change. That's why we need to change the mining paradigm. And the question that we're asking now, why generate waste in the first place? Why do we have to have mining and processing? Why not integrated mining and processing? And we are not in the business of mining. We are in the business of metal extraction. So why not think metal extraction right on the face? Why do you have to mine an ore and then process to get the value out of it? So the thing is, can we look at metal extraction right on the face? And even if we have some waste coming out of it, can we make some byproducts? Like, alumina, there's plenty of alumina or iron, things like that in our tailings. Why can't we use that as a way to produce them, and also can we use some of the mine dumps, for example, to make construction material for the communities, you know, or building roads, things like that. So we really have to think very hard. And my feeling is this is going to happen only when we really work together. And we all, and to make this happen, we really need a step change in the S curve that we mentioned before. And if you look into the actual value, it's quite significant. We're talking about more than 20% return, capital cost one quarter of what we have right now. You need only 15% of the water needs, about 40% of the energy that we use right now, and maybe around less than 10% of the waste that we generate, that we do now. So what we really need is radical innovation, and again, the dancing of the invention and innovation is actually quite critical. And the question that I like to ask is, why are we trying to do all this? We're trying to do all this to make this world a better place to live. Unless we really understand and imbibe this ethos in our culture, it is very difficult to make a paradigm shift. So I'd like to emphasize that we're all working together to make this world a better place to live, and this is the way we can take ourselves to the next paradigm shift. Thank you.
Thank you. Just stick around. We have a time for a few questions. If you have a question, just raise your hand, and we have a few roaming mics going around. We have one on this side and one on that side. You made was there a question there?
No, I just...
Okay.
There's a question there.
Oh, there's one right there.
Barun, Jacques Eckstein from Curtin University. I think one of the big problems that we're seeing, if we go back to your S-curves earlier on, I think the third or the whatever slide where you showed universities and then the corporate groups within the institutions, and then the final, you had three groups there. The big problem is that middle group has been basically removed in many companies. Barrick has retained some of it. I think Newmont has retained some part of a group there. But if we look at what's been happening at BHP and Rio and a lot of those Anglo-American as well, the research lab has either been massacred to nothing. And I think this is the key thing. A lot of the lack of innovation that we're seeing recently is because, you know, we've got an executive board in companies with accountants and lawyers and maybe a few geologists ruling the roost and having certain expectations. And then we have the universities becoming, you know, totally a separate entity that is running on in a sense, independent from that thinking. And that link, that was the translation link between the need of the mining company and the operational needs, and transforming and translating that into a research and a research need and an innovation, that has been disappearing. And I think this is one of the key problems that we're seeing in the innovation space, is that we don't have that translation ability anymore because we cut out that layer.
Absolutely. No, fully agree with you, Jacques. I think that's a big mistake we have made. And just by taking, in fact, this is a statement that I got from one of my peers from another major mining company. Just by taking the driver out of the truck, it doesn't mean that you're changing the mining paradigm. You're definitely improving efficiency, great from a safety point of view. You're not actually changing the mining paradigm. So by removing those people from that role, and by not interacting with the centers of excellence, universities, we are doing a big mistake. Because unless we have the invention on board, it's not going to happen for us. We talk about open innovation in the mining industry, but that's not going to take us anywhere else. It can definitely help us improve the existing paradigm, but it's not going to take us to the next paradigm that we're looking for. Thank you. Yeah.
There's one right over here in the middle.
Yeah, this is Holger Lieberwitt from Freiberg Mining University. I think your presentation was amazing. One point I missed, essentially, it's the silo thinking. I think there's a lot of potential in overcoming the silo mentality in the mining companies, and I'm talking about my background also being in industry. Talking about communication between the mining people, the operations people, the maintenance people, the processing people, there's a lot of potential in, What is your experience in Barrick to overcome the silo mentality in this field and be using this as a driver for innovation?
You know, it's a very good question. In fact, I don't know if you have heard recently, you know, Barrick is going into digitization. The whole of Barrick will be digitized, which is quite open now. We have partnered with Cisco on that, and we are not going to leave that alone because that's a big challenge, big silos. So the thing is, human beings, we can make ourselves siloed, but data that's coming from the mine, for example, your mine dispatch, for example, you have heaps of data. In a PI system, you only use maybe 1 or 2% of the data. 99% of the data is actually going out, waste. So we have all this data coming out. So the idea is to integrate all the data and do analytics on it and to get the insight that we're looking for, whether it's mine to mill or whether it's optimization of your combination or flotation or leaching. So my feeling is digitization is going to be an enabler, but we should not disregard the change management side of things in terms of people themselves. You know. So obviously, this is not going to be easy, but my strong feeling is with this digitization initiative that we have on board, this is going to help us in a big way.
I think we're going to have to move on. Okay. Thank you. Thanks. So please join me in thanking Barun. Barun made many interesting points, but two of them came to my mind. One is when we talk about innovation, it's not a shortage of ideas. There's lots of ideas, and we're going to see, you know, a lot of them in these 4 days. It's the implementation. And the second one is if you actually calculate it out, if you have a 1 gram per ton ore and you have a strip ratio of 5 to 10, you're moving hundreds and hundreds of ton of material to make 1 ounce of gold. And there's actually more value in the aluminum, the silicon, the iron, than there is in the gold, and yet we waste 99.999%. So it's quite interesting. Okay, so now we're going to move on to our second plenary. And there was a question yesterday from the audience about, you know, does that presenter have a TED Talk? And the answer today is yes, our presenter does have a TED Talk. So our second speaker is Donald Sadoway, who's the John F. Elliot Professor of Material Chemistry in the Department of Material Science and Engineering at MIT. He obtained his BASC in Engineering Science, his MASC in Chemical Metallurgy, and his PhD in Chemical Metallurgy, all from the University of Toronto. After a year of postdoc study at MIT as a NATO fellow, Dr. Sadoway joined the faculty in 1978. He's the author of over 150 scientific papers and the holder of 20 US patents. His research is directed towards the development of rechargeable batteries for grid-level storage and environmentally sound technologies for the extraction of metals. The fundamental tenet that drives his choice of problems is how to reduce costs at the discovery stage. To push these ideas from lab bench to marketplace, he is the founder of two companies, Ambry and Boston Electrometallurgical. With recordings of his chemistry lectures broadcast throughout the world on MIT OpenCourseWare, his impact on engineering education extends far beyond the lecture hall at MIT. Viewed over 1.5 million times, his TED Talk is a narrative about inventing inventors as much as it is about inventing technology. In 2012, he was named by Time Magazine as one of the most influential, 100 most influential people in the world. Please welcome Dr. Sadoway to the stage.
Well, good morning. In keeping with the theme today of innovation, I'm going to move downstream a little bit, and I'm going to talk about metal extraction and also, in parallel, tell a story by analogy. Perhaps you can draw some lessons from this that you can use in your own way. As the title implies, it's sustainability that drives a lot of what I'm doing. And I've given it an alternative title, which is the research paradigm shift. I fully accept all of the criticisms that are leveled against the university as being isolated, driven to conduct research for high impact in quotable journals. And whether that has any impact on industry or not, is irrelevant, because at some level, career building and solving societal problems are orthogonal pathways. And I was on that path, I must confess, for almost 30 years. And then about in the mid-2000s, I started thinking more deeply about what I could do in the direction of something for grid-level storage. And I realized that if you're going to talk about grid-level storage, you're talking about the electricity market. And you have to think about cost at the very early discovery stage. In other words, inventing cool chemistry and then getting it into the hands of the manufacturing people and hoping that they'll chase down the cost curve is not good enough. You have to think about cost at the discovery stage, and that's going to be some of the theme that you'll see weaving through this presentation. So the first part, I'm going to talk about metals extraction, then I'm going to talk about the liquid metal battery. So what I looked at with metals extraction, that was going back about 20 years. These ideas were developing in my mind, but I really hadn't articulated them. Unfavorable byproducts, you know, with the steel making, you make CO2. Aluminum electrolysis also makes CO2. It takes about a half a ton of carbon to make a ton of aluminum. And yet we've got very high capital costs, and that at some level hinders innovation. Even if you have a solution, if you're going to make waste of all of the capital investment, people are going to be loath to adopt. It's almost as though I want radical innovation, but don't change anything. So this is an awkward situation to be in. So why is metal production so dirty? Well, these processes are over 100 years old. And there was an attitude of indifference towards the environment in those days. This is a cartoon from the New Yorker about 20 years ago, where there's smoke, there's money, and we thought about this as that's fine. When I was a child growing up in Oshawa, Ontario, I remember there was an electroplating operation upstream, and one spring I went down to the creek with a number of friends, and all the fish were dead. And we looked at each other and said, gee, that's too bad. There was no outrage. It was accepted. That's the cost of progress. Well, today we view things a little bit differently, because thanks to the images from space, we tend to regard this as our home. So being a professor, everything gets canonical with me. So I always go back to the basics, and that served me well. It's sort of counterintuitive. People would think that if you want to innovate, then you should be teaching at the cutting edge in subjects that are right on the edge of your discipline. And I found the opposite. I found that by going back to the primary subject, teaching general chemistry, that formed new associations in my mind. So we know that everybody in this audience knows that metals, very few of them occur as bare elements. Most of them occur as compounds, mainly oxides, and I use that term generically. It could be oxide, it could be sulfide, and so on. Then they're beneficiated to give us high purity feed, and then we use reducing agents. And the reducing agents are of a really small palette, carbon, hydrogen, some other metal, or the electron. And when I start thinking about sustainability, I think about the electron as the most sustainable, because the electron can be generated carbon-free, and it comes in only one purity. It's 100% pure. So I think that might be the pathway forward. So if I were going to invent a new extraction technology, clearly I want to reduce environmental impact. I would like to reduce production costs, both capital and operating costs. Flexibility in raw materials. We heard from the last speaker about variability in what's coming from the mine. We want to improve metal quality. That's something that most of my colleagues don't get. They think that if I gave you aluminum that was produced in an environmentally sound manner, but it's in a manner, but it's a little bit more costly and it's a little bit inferior, but it's environmentally sound, nobody wants that. It has to be better. So that was the impetus for molten oxide electrolysis, which I invented at MIT about 20 years ago. So I don't know how this happened, I'm sorry. So we know that the metals are found as oxides. If you accept my thesis that the electron is the best reducing agent, and as my students know from freshman chemistry, like dissolves like, then that is the impetus for molten oxide electrolysis. In other words, why are we converting oxides to chlorides and then reducing chlorides with some other metal? Why don't we take the oxides and dissolve them? And if we do that, maybe we can even do that at the mine face. So this is the disruptive idea, where we will electrolyze the ores as themselves. So this is the heart of the cell. It looks a little bit like an aluminum cell, like a Hall-Heroult cell. You've got an anode at the top. If you, let's say you're feeding in iron oxide, by the passage of electric current, you convert to liquid iron, which pools at the bottom, and with an inert anode, you'd make oxygen at the top. And this would give you much lower capital costs. If we wanted to build a greenfield steel plant today with a blast furnace, basic oxygen furnace, coke ovens, et cetera, well, you're talking on the order of billions of dollars and a productivity of millions of tons per year. And there's no in between. You don't want to build a blast furnace that's 1,000 cubic meters. You're going to come in at 10,000 cubic meters, or else you're just not going to have your economy of scale. Here, you can get in at hundreds of thousands of tons and still be sensible. And of course, the direct processing of the oxide ore means that you can plug into the existing supply chain so that you can use not only the ore that you're getting right now, but you don't need a sinter plant. You can feed in fines, you can feed in big chunks, because in the end, it's all turning into liquid anyways. And this is the thing that really shocked us. If the red line is the benchmark of about 1.85 tons of carbon dioxide per ton of iron metal. Obviously, if your electricity comes from nuclear or hydro, your carbon footprint is going to be vanishingly small. On the right, you have electricity generated from coal, so that's not prudent, because all you've done is you've shifted the CO2 generation from the smelter to the electricity plant. But the bar in the middle is the one that was surprising. If you generated electricity by natural gas, your carbon footprint still goes down with an electrolytic route to metal if you're using oxide electrolysis. So there are some scientific things that have to be done. I can't have a student do a thesis at MIT called A New Way to Make Iron. I've got to give it some lofty title. So I know that the molten oxides and transition metals are electronic conductors, and I'll say a little bit more about that later on. So there's some basic science there. And of course, the inert anode that can operate at 1700 degrees, that's a great materials challenge. So I can give a title of the thesis something like Electronic Properties of Molten Ferrites. So that satisfies the thesis requirements. And really, we're working on an electrolytic way to make metal. So here's some examples of work that's been done at MIT over the years. This is a crucible that's about 3 inches in diameter. And this is a electrolytic iron that was made at current density of about 1 amp per square centimeter. This is some more of this stuff. Here's an example of looking down into the cell. This is operating. You can see at the anode, you can see bubbles of oxygen evolving. And at the cathode, there's a plate in which iron is forming. This is operating at 1570 degrees Celsius. We've done nickel. Nickel from oxide is trivial. It melts at a lower temperature than iron, so this is nickel direct in oxide electrolysis. Chromium melts at 1900 degrees, which is higher than any of my furnaces could go at the time, so we used iron as a starter, fed chromium oxide, and made liquid ferrochromium. This is all carbon-free, so I've shown you I can make carbon-free iron, carbon-free nickel, and carbon-free ferrochromium. That means I could make virgin stainless, and I would carbonize it to the level that I wanted, as opposed to having to get the carbon out. Manganese, it's low melter, it's 1244, so we did this one in a furnace where we had a hot zone in the center and had liquid metal below and above the melt, and generated high purity ferromanganese. This conforms to the ASTM spec. And then this is some work that actually my postdoc, who's here, Chanaka de Alwis, did with me. This is some voltammetry of molten titanates at 1550. This is titanium. the background and then with titanium oxide added. So this is going from titanium oxide directly to titanium, no Kroll process, no carbochlorination, no dioxin, and result is here. In this case, we actually ran with a carbon anode, and the result was at 1725 degrees in a molybdenum crucible. This is liquid titanium in one step. And then this is the work that we did several years ago to produce a practical inert anode. We're not going to put platinum anodes into a steel mill. That's not going to be practical. So this is a ferrochromium alloy, and this shows the results of operating at a temperature of about 1565. 2.5 hours, it's still intact. If it weren't stable, it would have been destroyed in no time. And the other thing I want to say is that I still have to build the careers of the young people who work with me. Otherwise, they won't. So we published this in Nature, which is arguably the premier scientific journal on the planet. And this launched the careers of the two co-authors. The first co-author, Antoine Eleanor, is now a professor at MIT. And the second one, Lan Yin, is now a professor at Tsinghua University, which is arguably the Harvard of China. And this was the thing that launched it, because these universities are wrapped around the axle of Hirsch factors and quotability and so on. So I figure if I'm going to publish, I'm sorry, I'm not going to publish in Met Trans, because that's not going to launch their careers. That's the world we live in. I can't change that, but I do want to launch the careers of these brilliant young people. So I've shown you MOE can operate as a platform for conversion of oxide to metal. We started off with steel. We went through various other transition metals. We're looking at rare earths right now, and we've done titanium. We think zirconium would be a trivial stretch from there. So we wanted to go to a self-heating cell. See, all the cells that I've been showing you don't operate like a Hall cell because they're too small. Their heat losses are too great. So we have to put these things into a furnace. But a Hall cell operates self-heating. So we had to scale up, and we can't do that on campus, so I formed a company called Boston Electrometallurgical, and we've got now 6 people at about a 6,000 square foot facility in the Boston area. And we've designed, built, and commissioned a cell. Its power supply is 10,000 amperes, and it is operated at temperatures as high as 1,900 degrees Celsius. So this was an integration of heat, mass transfer, mathematical modeling, transport phenomena, and practical extraction metallurgy. And the Hall cell operates at 960. No one has made an electrolytic cell that operates at 1900 degrees C. What's the inter-electrode gap? What's the viable linear dimension? We don't want to make it bigger than we have to, but if we don't make it big enough, it'll freeze. We won't be able to generate enough heat. So we designed it, we built it, and it worked the first time. And we said we'd have pilot scale metal production by the end of 2015, and we did. I'll show you some examples. This is an image of the cell operating. You can see we're tapping. Unlike the Hall cell, we're not siphoning out the top. We're tapping. We figured out how to be able to open and close that tap hole. And in the right where the signage says operator completing metal tap, you can see a human form with a shroud over his head and hand extending. So that gives you an idea of the size. It's about 1 meter in diameter. And we haven't produced nanograms. I'm not interested in nanotechnology. It's too small for my taste. So we've produced in aggregate over a ton of metal. These are various billets, each of them weighing some kilograms. And these are various ferroalloys. So what's next? Well, some metals, as you know, are found in the ground as sulfides, and you talk about converting to oxide and hydrometallurgy and so on. So I asked myself, what about direct electrolysis of sulfides? But I didn't have any money. You know, the Bureau of Mines is gone in the United States. You can't get funded for anything like this. It's not sexy enough. So we were doing some work on the liquid metal battery, and I had this idea of a battery with 2 layers of electrolyte. One layer is immiscible in the other layer, but they're both electrolytes. And one of them happened to be an antimony sulfide, and the other one happened to be an alkali chloride. And what ended up, instead of having a battery that charged, we started producing antimony liquid at the bottom of the cell, and that meant that there had to be a compensating reaction at the other electrode, which we determined was sulfur evolution. And so this was the birth of molten sulfide electrolysis. By putting that second layer above, even though the sulfide is a very, very highly conductive, electronically conductive liquid, by putting the ionically conductive liquid on the top, that effectively breaks the connection from anode to cathode, and it facilitates electrolysis. So, because the traditional way would be to take the electronically conducting sulfide and dilute it in something that is not electronically conductive, and that works up to a point. But in this case, we didn't have to touch it. So this was an accidental discovery. And here's the data. There's the, on the left is the molten sulfide, and on the right is the antimony. And then this is sulfur coming off the other electrode. Well, now let's switch gears. I want to talk about energy storage. Electrochemistry is, for me, it's my passion because it's the way to convert dirt to metal by using electricity, and electricity is modernity. Everything you value as being 21st century is predicated on the availability of electricity. You try to go through a day without electricity, you can't do it. And this image is fantastic because it shows you the modern world, where it's dark. It's one of two conditions: either nobody lives there or the place hasn't been electrified. And by the way, you know this is a collage. This is not a NASA image. This is not the world at night. The world never looks like this. You know, when it's light here in North America, it's dark in Asia. When it's dark in North America, it's light. If the world ever looks like this, it's a really bad day for all of us. So can we imagine if we could have sustainable electricity, then that would give us a sustainable modernity. And that's the next the change that we're taking place. And I know there's all kinds of debate over the continued use of coal and so on and so forth, but sustainable. I'm not prescriptive on those things. And let me remind you that from my standpoint, that electricity began at the university under the hands of a professor, Alessandro Volta. Volta invented the battery in a laboratory and gave birth to a new field of science, electrochemistry, and new technologies, electroplating, electroforming, and served the basis for electrolytic extraction of metals. Volta's discovery proved something else, proved that a professor has utility. Until Volta, nobody imagined a professor could be of any use. But Volta showed that if you give a professor resources and leave him alone, he's liable to produce something that has societal value. The question is how to make sure that they focus on the right questions. All right, so cost is the barrier. Cost is the barrier when it comes to batteries. That's the problem. At grid level storage, nothing works. So I had this chart constructed by one of my students. And what you see is that it's a semi-log plot, so down here, all of the battery technologies don't amount to anything. That's less than 0.1%. The only thing that works is pumped hydro. The other thing I learned from this is if I don't get a battery that's below $500 a kilowatt hour, it's not going to make any difference. So I got to invent to a price point, not just invent cool chemistry. If I want to end with the paper in Nature, just invent cool chemistry. If I want to change the world, I got to get below $500 a kilowatt hour. So for inspiration, I didn't look to batteries. I disregarded everything everybody else would say about batteries. And I didn't look to battery experts because I believe that culture is more important than strategy. You can have the fantastic strategy with great people in a poisonous culture and you will accomplish nothing. So it doesn't matter what the culture of the university is, the culture of my own research group is different. And with the right culture, I can have innovation. So I look for inspiration to the aluminum smelter. Why? It was invented in 1886 by Hall in the US and Hérouille in France. There they are. Hérouille's on the left, Hall is on the right. They were both born in the same year. They both died in the same year. And they met once in 1911 when
Hall was getting the Perkins Medal by the American Chemical Society, and Hérouille came from France to speak at the banquet in testimony. Even though they were fierce competitors, they respected each other, and they got along together, not like the backstabbing that occurs in the life sciences today. Well, they were both born in the same year. They must have been the same age in 1886. 52, 42, 32, 22. Two 22-year-olds changed the world with their discovery of the new process to make aluminum. But let's not forget one other fact. Aluminum is the third most abundant element in the Earth's crust. If they'd invented this process for palladium, I don't think it would have made much difference. So using that as my inspiration, I conceived of this liquid metal batteries. Three layers, light metal, very electro positive on top. Here I'm showing magnesium, a very electronegative metal, a really bad metal, a semi-metal like antimony on the bottom and a molten salt in between. They float on top of one another. There's no membranes, no separators. And on discharge, the magnesium wants to alloy with the antimony, goes into the electrolyte and sends electrons through the external circuit. And then on charging, we electro-refine. So I'm running an electro-refinery every time. So you purify the electrodes and the electrolyte and you restore the battery to its pristine condition. In fact, over the first 10, 20 cycles, the battery actually gets better. And it has no memory because it's liquid. And it has very, very high charge transfer kinetics. Everybody knows this from aluminum smelting or magnesium smelting because it's liquid to liquid. And this is my team, one student, David Bradwell. He and I were both born in Toronto, as a matter of fact, in different years. And David, he looks pretty worried here because he's not sure this thing's going to work. What I didn't tell him was that I wasn't sure it was going to work, but I mentored him. And how did I mentor him? I told him, it's going to work. You want a PhD, so figure out how to make it work, and he did. And he had no background in electrochemistry. He had a bachelor's degree in physics from Queen's University. He ended up at MIT, and I took him into my group. And I taught him how to think, and I gave him a lot of freedom, and he failed. The early work was abysmal, but we eventually made it work. He's now the CTO of Ambry. And then along came the energy initiative, and I had the good fortune of getting some money from the French energy giant Total. And then when President Obama was elected, he chose Stephen Chu to be his energy secretary, and they started ARPA-E, which is the only, it was a moment in time when they stopped funding incremental improvements and took big chances. And then I was sitting on $13 million, and this became my group. About 20 people, graduates, undergraduates, postdocs, and none of them was schooled in electrochemistry. They were bright, they were young, and they had a rich, nurturing culture, but they didn't have a background in battery technology or electrochemistry. And international, she's from Spain, he's from Korea, these are from China. In fact, the two in the background, I'll show you, they're now professors in Wuhan, red carpet treatment for another Nature paper. She's from France, Trinidad. He's from Tahiti with a PhD in high energy physics in Paris. She's from Poland. David and I are both from Toronto. And I hired a few token Americans, and that was my team. And I'll tell you something, with that team, 20 times 3 is more than 3 times 20. If I'd had the same manpower spread over 20 years, I wouldn't be standing here right now. So there's a critical mass as well. So to the point that the questioner from the audience made about the decimation of the corporate research labs, it's not that the lab doesn't exist, but below a critical mass size, there isn't enough peer conversation to give the ideas the fertile ground that they need to grow in. So I'm not going to drag you through all of the details, but we've tested over 1,000 cells, many combinations of alloys and salts. There's very little data on this stuff in the literature. People, you look at the data on steel, copper, magnesium, aluminum, plenty of data. But you look at even a binary phase diagram for some of the metals that we're working with, they don't exist. Or you know what's worse than no data? Bad data. So you got a phase diagram that was measured in 1935 in the former Soviet Union, and you're running a cell, and it's supposed to be liquid, and the cell is already solid. So what do? You have to take a detour, you have to measure all the phase diagrams yourself. And this is the paper that appeared in Nature on one of our combinations, lithium on the top and antimony lead on the bottom. And that resulted in career launching for a few other people. But this is the thing that makes this battery worth the effort. I mean, everybody's got a great battery. By the way, Edison said in 1883, when a man begins to work on energy storage, it brings out the latent propensity to lie. So don't listen to battery people. Only listen to their customers. So this is the thing, fade rate. So you know, this is showing a battery that's operating at 300 milliamps per square centimeter, which is pretty high. It's about half the current density of an aluminum cell. 93% depth of discharge. So this isn't sweet spot like a Prius between 60 and 40%. This is full charge to almost full discharge. And this is after about 1,000 cycles. And the fade rate is 0.00009% per cycle. What does that mean? If you cycle it every day for 10 years, that's 3,650 cycles, and it still retains 99.4% of its nameplate capacity. Now that's worth fighting for. If I put lithium ion on this graph, it'd be sinking like a stone. But it doesn't matter, because we trade our phones every 2 years, we trade our laptops about every 3 years. Who cares? When I was a child, we used to say, I'm trading in my Mercedes, the ashtray is full. You know, so we can't do that with batteries for grid level storage. And we started a company, it was at David's urging. It was called Liquid Metal Battery Corporation, which is probably one of the most boring names you can think of. And then a couple of years later, we changed the name to Ambry. It has nothing to do with that hockey playing town in Switzerland. The battery was invented in Cambridge, and Ambry comes out of the heart of Cambridge, and Ambry.com was still available, so we took it. And our Series A funding came from Bill Gates. Now, how did I meet Bill Gates? Not because I wrote a dynamite article for the Wall Street Journal, not because I gave a talk at some TED conference. It's because I taught freshman chemistry. And I was teaching freshman chemistry for 16 years, and in the early 2000s, as the internet got more and more bandwidth, they put all of my chemistry lectures online as part of the Open Courseware Initiative, where MIT was going to put all of its lecture material available for free to the world. Bill Gates was told he should watch some of my lectures. He ended up watching all 35 of my chemistry lectures. And then in August of 2009, I get a note from a woman who says she's his secretary. He's coming to Boston. Would I have 90 minutes to meet with him? Well, I disregarded the email. So I thought the students had hacked into my account. They were just making a fool of me. So about 10 days later, she wrote again and said, perhaps you didn't see my email, but Mr. Gates would really like to meet with you. And I said, well, maybe this is real. So I said, okay, fine. And he met with me. It was a day after, it was a Friday. I just finished teaching. We sat for 90 minutes in my office. We talked about my lectures. The first thing he said to me, he says, you need to get better camera work on those things. So he'd been watching even year by year. And then we talked about computers and education, distance learning, all sorts of things. And then he started talking about batteries. So tell me about your research. And this was 2009, before the ARPA-E funding. So David and I had nothing in the way of results. So I sketched this thing out on a whiteboard. And he said two things. First thing he said was, you know, it seems to me the approach to stationary storage ought to be different from the approach to mobile storage. And I said, you're right. You're one of the few people who understands that. I got colleagues down the hall who think they're going to put lithium-ion batteries in shipping containers. I said, that's crazy. And the second thing, he says, if you ever spin this out as a company, let me know. I'd be willing to put some money into it. So a year later, my students went out and saw him. He became our first investor. So that's working. Now, this is the long road. So where are our batteries? We're still on the road. It's 5 years. If I told you I had a five-year startup in IT, you'd say, what are you talking about? But you know, 5 years in something that's capital intensive and substantive, it's nothing. But 2 years ago, we opened this manufacturing facility in Marlborough, Massachusetts. The tall man there in the center is Phil Giudice, our CEO. A man next to him is the governor at the time of Massachusetts, Deval Patrick. And this will give you a sense of what these are cells. They're 4-inch square, 80 amp hours per cell, and then eventually we're now building 8-inch squares. It's 380 amp hours for a single cell. This is a lithium-ion battery. This is what's coming out of the Gigafactory. It's the 18650. That's 3 amp hours, which means that if you wanted to put a 1 megawatt hour on a 50 square meter footprint, you'd need 93,000 of those cells. I'll give them to you for free. Somebody's got to put those things together. We need 2,600. So there's a scale there. But that's the thing. You put these things in, and they're going to last for... They're not going to fail because the electrochemistry fails. They're going to fail because something else lets go. All right. So what's next? We took on Zebra. Zebra was invented in South Africa in 1985. Liquid sodium on top with beta alumina separator, molten salt, sodium aluminate, chloroaluminate, and on the bottom, nickel chloride. But it's never made it to market because of the paper-thin membrane of beta alumina. So we took that on, and we figured out a way to get rid of the beta alumina membrane and to get rid of the solid nickel chloride. So now we have liquid metal on the bottom going to liquid salt, so it's a liquid-liquid interface, and no ceramic. But I can't tell you that right now. It's not because of the IP. I'm not hiding anything because of the IP. It's because if I tell you what I'm doing here, I won't be able to get published. You know, we couldn't publish the first paper on the liquid metal battery. Nature held it for almost a year and then rejected it because one of the reviewers found this image that I had given at a talk. I hadn't given any specifics, and he said, this is not the first time he's talking about this, so I'm not going to tell you what I'm doing. Let's keep going because I want to finish on time. All right, so let's end with the big learning. So what have I learned through all of this odyssey in both the molten oxide electrolysis and the liquid metal battery? Buck the thinking. Everybody else in molten salt electrolysis, everybody else in batteries would say you have to operate at room temperature because the battery, you want to put it to your face. I don't pay for attributes I don't need. So I said, no, I want to go to high temperature because I get more space-time yield in mineral processing, and I get faster charge transfer kinetics in the battery. Round-trip efficiency is 75%, even accounting for the heat loss, which is on a par with pumped hydro. And I don't get the capacity fade. Scaling, the gigafactory, you're going to get cheaper by building many. No, you can build too many. I said make them fewer, but make them bigger. And last, human resources. They say, hire experts. Get the brightest minds worked in this field for 40 years. Get them all in the room. You know what? If I go into a room and I talk about liquid metal battery, the strongest naysayer is a battery expert. Battery expert would tell me, this cannot work. This is crazy. I get novices, bright young people, put them into a flourishing culture, turn them loose, and you'd be astonished at what they're capable of doing. So this is my battle cry to my students. Be realistic, ask for the impossible, and sometimes with enough ingenuity, the impossible becomes the inevitable. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I don't know about the rest of the audience, but that sure was sexy enough for me. Thank you very much.
Okay, good.
And we've learned today that it's not a shortage of idea, it's a shortage of, it's the culture. We need the right culture, so it's a challenge to everybody in this room within the mining industry to change the culture. Do we have any comments or questions from the audience? We have one right up here, first row, second row.
Excuse me, I think that was excellent. I just want to quote an interview with the chief scientist at DuPont 25 years ago in the Financial Times. He said in the very first paragraph, it's not seeing is believing, but first believe and then you can see. Mm. So I just wanted to summarize all of this, but if you can do that, everything is, I think, possible. Thank you.
Right in the middle, there's a couple in the middle.
Uh, I've seen your literature because I've been involved with surface treating in molten salts, processes that don't seem to have caught on commercially, and I wonder if you have looked into the literature and have some thoughts as to why that hasn't caught on, carburization, boronization, and so forth.
I can't explain non-existence. I mean, there's either hesitancy on the part of people in the industry because they're risk averse, or they've done the cost modeling and they see that, yes, it works, but it doesn't work at a lower price point than the existing technology. But, you know, innovation in the industry may come from outside the industry. I mean, the lithium-ion battery did not come from the battery industry. Sony was building batteries for a new set of handycams and Walkman in the late 80s, and the nickel metal hydride battery was only going to give us about a 1 hour of runtime. And they pieced together the discovery by John Goodenough, a professor, of lithium cobalt oxide, and another professor, Stan Whittingham, that graphite would intercalate lithium, and they put those two together and said, we can make a rechargeable lithium-ion battery, and they went, this is 1989, there was no China in the picture at that time, they went to all the big battery companies in Japan and said, build this, here's an open PO, and every one of them, Matsushita, GS Yuasa, Hitachi, every one of them said, no, we refuse, because we've just invested all this money in nickel metal hydride capacity. So Sony does the unprecedented, and they say, well, if we're going to have this battery, we're going to go into the battery business. And they built the battery, and along came cell phones, and they bought the lithium ion. Along came laptops, they bought the lithium ion, and they buried nickel metal hydride. And now they're all producing nickel metal, forgive me, they're all producing lithium ion. And they not only did not want to adopt, they stood in the roadway. So, you know. Look at telephones. AT&T Bell Labs. How many Nobel Prizes? Fantastic. What impact on the North American telephone system? Where did mobile telephony come from? Not from Bell Labs. In fact, you know when Disney came out with the Mickey Mouse telephone, AT&T made it absolutely impossible for you to connect that to the landline network. So innovation, it's going to come from there.
There was a question in the middle, yep.
Professor, thank you very much for excellent talk, exciting. I have a challenge to you.
Sure.
You know, my iPhone dies every few hours. It pisses me off when I needed to take a picture. So can you assembly a group of young, innovative people, like you said, a very innovative culture, develop a small enough cell, I mean the battery for my cell phone that it can run for a month. That would be great.
Well, I'm working on it. But I got to get this other stuff done first. So. What's the next frontier? The next frontier is mobile power for electric vehicles. And of course, that would apply for mobile phones. And it has to be beyond lithium. Lithium has its attributes, but we all know what's happening right now with the recall of the Galaxy Note 7. Could I give you something that has superior performance to lithium ion without the safety threat of thermal runaway and made of something that's more earth abundant? And that's what I'm working on. Stay tuned.
I think we're going to have to cut it off.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Actually, I think Professor Sadoway has that battery. He just can't tell us about it or he won't get it published. So just a couple of housekeeping notes before we close off. Lunch today is in room 208, which I believe is this room here. Tonight we have the IMPC Awards Banquet and the announcement of the current Lifetime Achievement Award recipient. If you look in your books today, we have some IMPC commissions, the one on education is going out through today, and some excellent papers in that one. and the COM asked me, METSOC asked me to note that the COM 2007 call for abstracts is open. I know I've learned a lot today. Both speakers, Barun Gorain, Professor Sadoway, have given us some excellent points. Please welcome and thank them both. Thank you.